आवाज आ रही है पीछे स्क्रीन
जी सर आ रही
या टीचर कम साउंड कमिंग फ्रॉम समवेयर
आई रिक्वेस्ट एवरीबॉडी टू प्लीज पुट देमसेल्व्स ऑन म्यूट साधना यस थैंक यू सो मच
सो मैम आई थिंक आई जस्ट टेक अ मिनट टू बिगिन जस्ट गिव मी अ मिनट्स टाइम
यस सर
Definitely beginning that. So great. Good evening, everyone. And we wanted to be particular about beginning at the right time. So we're starting at 3 o'clock itself. It's 1 minute late. And just a little update on what happened, why happened, because a lot of interesting things are happening. And we feel very privileged that we are part of those interesting things that are going on. So it began with the concept of graphic novels, wherein the Palace School Jaipur wanted to do something different. And like Man didn't want more of a comic book. She wanted more of a story depth in it. She wanted to be more, you know, substantial of more.
Sandeep sir, you are on mute.
No, we can hear him.
No, he is audible, ma'am.
He's audible.
He's audible. He's audible.
Okay. So I'll continue. And then we realized, ma'am realized that she wanted to make it really interesting, more interdisciplinary. So what you'll all realize while doing this novel, The Camel with the Japi, it has happened that a lot has evolved. So ma'am will be telling you what it began, where it reached. But for me, most important thing for you to tell you is that everyone is going to do it their way. You're just hearing ma'am with her experience, but otherwise, it's all free. No one is, no prototypes are made. No one has to follow the procedures. No one has to do anything. It has to be original. It has to be the way you are happy with things. And that's the way it's going to go on. Now, why are we having this meeting? Well, we were happy making one Camel with a Japi, and we managed to meet Anita Karol ma'am, Biswajit sir, and Manoj sir in this process. But Anita ma'am, as usual, the moment she saw this, she said, why only one? Why only one mein hum log atak jaate hain? Because it's not easy making one. Graphic novel was still a different game. So she said, nee, I want 15 of all other states also. So Jyoti ma'am was sitting with us in their office that time. So two unhone keh diya, she'll manage. And while Urvashi ma'am and myself were coming back to Jaipur, we tried to get other schools to come on board. And that is why you all are here. Another interesting part happened is that after that list got completed, 2-3 schools still wanted to join in. So just yesterday, I sent a message to Anita ma'am saying that, ma'am, 3-4 schools are still wanting to join in. It will be very unfair if we don't give them a chance. So she said, fine. Will they be able to collaborate with the existing schools? I said, ma'am, I have my doubts whether any school would want to collaborate, especially from a different city, with a different city. So it's still open. But she said, if they don't want to collaborate, then fine. Let them do what they feel like doing and let them make more novels. There's no harm in that. So that's the way it is. So over to Urvashi ma'am, she's the principal of the Palace School, and this project has been done under the MSMS2, that is Maharashtra Mansingh Mission 2, plus Jaipur, wherein we were training people, and our job right now is also to train people. Of course, in acknowledgement, please make sure that we are there. And I think after you've gone through the session, you have anything to ponder upon, you can still put up queries, but I'm sure most of the teachers will be able to do it their own sweet way. So thank you, Anita ma'am, for giving us the session. She may just barge in anytime because she also got the link. And Biswaji sir will also step in when he's free. And from the Palace Museum, we have got Ramadat ma'am, executive trustee, and Reema Huja ma'am, the director, museum. So if they are coming in, we'll just take a 1 minute break to welcome them. Otherwise, over to Urvashi ma'am. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. And good evening, everybody. And welcome to this session of making a series of novels under the initiative of Ek Bharat, Shresth Bharat. So what I will just share with you is the process that we have undergone to do this novel. I had to look back to think what was the process, and I realized that the process did come through because the work we did just grew organically, as Sir said. It just evolved as it came along. But then we realized that there was a certain structure to it. And since we've been through the process and the book has come out, so I'm just here to share the way we did it. As Sir said, each is welcome to take their own way of doing it. This is just a way of showing you that this is one of the ways it can be done, or it may be done by you. So we'll just go through the process in a very quick way. Can we have the, yes, so we have this, the orientation session for making of Ek Bharat, Shresth Bharat, a series of novels. Then we'll be talking about the making of The Camel with the Japi, the entire process, as I just said to you. So, and the next is you're going to see the cover page of the novel. This is what we have made. Now, if you look at the cover page, the interesting thing is that this is a novel on Assam and Rajasthan. So there's a very beautiful mingling of both the cultures on the cover page itself. You can see the rhino wearing the Rajasthani pag and the camel wearing the Assamese japi. And then you have the fish and the conch and the jutis and the drums and the sarangi. So it's a very interesting mix of the cultures on the page itself that is here in front of you. Next slide, please. So let's start. So of course, the first thing that needs to be done is identify the theme, which is of course already decided for all the schools who are interested to do this. So the theme of course is Ek Bharat, Shresth Bharat. And you would be writing on the state that you have chosen, the paired states that you have chosen. I think some of you belong to the state where you will be writing about your own state and maybe another state. Some of you may not be belonging to the state you have chosen at all. So that will be more interesting and more challenging. So that is it. So the theme is decided. Next, of course, we see that because maybe this is the first time some of you would be doing a full-length writing piece. So it always makes sense to read books of similar genre to get clarity. So you have The Camel with the Japi for you for reference. So you may pick it up. It is going to be available on Amazon very soon. And the next is, next slide, please. The first very important thing is to know your reader. Whom are you writing the book for? So I realized it was very important to know when I started, whom was I writing for? Because initially when we started, we thought it'll just be a project, you know, because we took it off as it was actually part of our art integrated learning project, wherein as all schools have given, we had given our states to be worked upon by the students, and they came up with very interesting pieces of information about Rajasthan and Assam, things that were not known to many of us. And so we decided to collate the whole thing together into an extensive story with illustrations. And so then we knew that while writing the book, I'm actually looking at students. So when I write the book, it has to be made sure that whatever I write is suitable for students. So that has thing has to be there in your mind. And for us, fortunately, the book fits in very well for any reader above grade 3-4. It can be, but if they're good readers already. Otherwise, from grade 5-6, 12th and even adults, even they can read the book. So know your reader for whom you're writing. Next. Whose perspective are you writing the book from? Are you writing it from the eyes of a child? Are you writing it from the eyes of an adult? That is also going to bring about a difference in the way you do your writing. So that is very important to understand from whose perspective are you writing. So that is there. Next is discuss the format. Now the format is very important. What is the format you wish to take up? So there would be some who may, like the one that we've written is a kind of a fictional travelogue kind of a thing, which is taking place, you know, with a story interwoven with it. We've taken the main protagonists on a journey, a physical journey through some of the key places of Rajasthan, and en route, they talk and discuss and discover more about Assam. So we've not shown them actually landing up in Assam in this story. So that has been our format. So what do you wish to do is absolutely up to you. How do you wish to take it up is something that you need to see. Next, set the time period and the timeline. Very important. Once you know what kind of a format you're taking up, you need to understand at what point of time are you setting the story? Because a lot of the what you write and what you discuss, decide, the characterization will depend upon the time period. If you wish to start from back in the bygone eras, somewhere when the kings still were there, then again your characters would be different. If you want to start from there and come up to the modern era, or some of you may wish to be in the future, 2050, 2060, and travel back and see what happened up to 1850, 1840, or maybe further back. So it's entirely up to you. So for us, this writing of the book commenced somewhere in November 2020, roughly around November 2020. And while doing the research, I realized that the timeline that I wanted to start the book was, I took it up in 2019. Now, why 2019? Because during the course of research, certain incidents came up connected to Rajasthan, which ultimately were connected to climate change. There's a lot of talk of climate change in the book. And I learned a lot about climate change while doing the research of the book. So we took up a certain incident that had happened at Sambar Lake, where a huge number of birds had died during a specific period of time. This was somewhere between 10th and 19th of November 2019. So this had turned into a big scandal and nobody knew why the birds were dying. So it was a big number. So that was something I wanted to incorporate in the story. So I decided that we would start the story somewhere by early November and then start the journey in such a way that they reach Sambar during between 10th and 20th of November. So a lot of thought was also given for the timeline and the time period. Also, you have to see why the time of year is important. Is it summer? Is it winter? Because your setting of the story will depend on that. What your characters are wearing, how they are behaving, what they are thinking, how they are feeling. A lot is governed by the season that they may be traveling in, or maybe when it is being a thing, because we were on a travel. So I got the opportunity to write about the dense fog and how they had to make their way through it, and when it was chilly and they had to cover themselves up well. So, the background scenarios get affected if you have your time period very clearly chalked out in your mind. Next slide, please. And of course, you need to zero down on the setting. It may be an urban setting, a semi-urban setting, a rural setting. Again, this will influence your story. This will influence your characters. It will influence the way your characters develop. It will also influence the kind of questions that will be coming through your characters, or the answers which will be coming through your characters. So you have to understand what setting do you have. So like we chose a very urban setting. We took up Jaipur to begin with, and then most of us did our travel in the urban areas and semi-urban areas. So we have talked about the deep interiors also. We have talked about certain areas deep in the countryside in Assam also. It is there, but then again one has to be careful how you weave it into your main narrative. Okay, next slide, please. Now, develop your characters and create a story outline. It's very important that you identify your main characters. And when identifying your main characters, remember you are going to be writing about two states. So you would ideally, probably, would be having characters coming from both the states. So how to develop the character of one of your protagonists who would be coming from a state you're not aware of is going to be a challenge. So in our case, our main protagonist, the main narrator, is from Assam. So the first thing that happened, the first bit of research went was, I actually sat down and I said, I don't know what kind of names are popular in Assam. I need to know that. Names and surnames. So that was a very small research, but an important one, to which took me through the names, very popular Assamese names and surnames. And then, of course, to develop a personality which would suit the name and the place from which the personality belonged. So you have to be careful about how you develop your characters. And of course, you need to have a broad framework of your storyline. As I said, we knew that we are going to be taking our characters on a journey. So that was, and the story evolved as the journey progressed. Now, when we talk of developing characters and creating a story outline, you also have the option of making your story inclusive. That was something I missed out. And so you can make your story have a very inclusive setup. Maybe include a character which may be a character having any kind of a special need. So that way you take the opportunity to sensitize the students and the readers about this very important point. So that is about characters and storyline. Next. Okay, debate on the title. So it's important that you decide upon a title when you start. It's easy to refer to the work when you have a title to begin with. Also, a very important thing that the title does is it keeps you tethered to your objective, to your main thing that you're looking at. Now, the title may evolve as the story progresses, or it may totally change. It may change a couple of times as your story progresses, but it's always good to have the title as a point of reference when we are doing this. Next. Okay. As I said, decide your route of travel, if traveling, like we took up traveling. So it's important that you progress. If you're traveling, you progress in an orderly manner. So we actually had to sit down and brainstorm that from Jaipur, within Jaipur, how are we going to see whatever we are going to see? So if some of you are aware of our city, then from City Palace, we took the group to Hawa Mahal. From there, we took the group up to the forts. And even the forts that they saw had to be in a particular order. And then coming down, they had to go for a night safari. So that from there, they had to go to Ranthambore, travel back, come back. Then en route from Sambar, they had to go to Jodhpur. So this entire route had to be mapped, because otherwise, it will make the narrative very haphazard. So you should know that when you are, if you're taking up a journey, or even if you're not in a journey, if you're talking about certain places, then there has to be some kind of a format and some kind of a, coherence to the way you tackle with your places. That's very, very important. Next slide, please. Okay. Another very important point is decide the educational topics your story would include. Now remember, we are primarily catering to students. It could be school students, it could be college students, and or it could be adults who are out of the formal learning system, but there's always much to learn about our country and different facets of our country. So when you do research about any specific city or area or zone of your chosen states, what are the things that you should look for? So here is a list of suggested topics, which of course we have incorporated these and a few more in the Camel with the Japi. So we have done research and we have brought out very interesting legends, myths, portions of history, geography, heroes of both the states. There's been a lot of talk on ecology, on biodiversity. There's been a lot of talk on climate change. There's been a lot of talk. There's been a whole chapter on heritage, the tangible and the intangible heritage. And I was like amazed because I learned so much while doing this. And so did all the people who have contributed, you know, teachers and students who have contributed their bit to the book. It has been a huge learning experience. Trade, commerce, the book has got, you know, chapters on arts and crafts of both the places, food, heritage food. Interesting, a lot of interesting thing came up when we did about the food, because the way, what kind of food is eaten in both the states, how the climate and sometimes the history also has an effect on the food of a certain area. And also the ways of cooking differ. So in Rajasthan, the how we all used to, you know, traditional cooking was done on the dung cakes by using that as a biofuel. And when you go to Assam, it is interesting because a lot of, so Anil Bhatwaji, can I just finish and then we take up the questions? I see your hand is raised. Okay, so different, you know, cooking is done in Assam, say maybe in the hollows of the bamboo, or steamed, wrapped up in banana leaves. Very interesting. So, you know, that's how we learn, and we learn to appreciate the diversity at every step in our country. Then so much about culture and festivals. And it was interesting to note that though both the places were very diverse, yet we had a lot of things which were similar. Even when we came to the dances, when we came to the festivals, they had something common in them. So this is where, you know, these topics, if you do research, and of course, there's so much more which has not been touched. So it's going to add a lot of depth to what you write. Next slide, please. And of course, a lot of incidental learnings will happen. Interesting information will come your way, which you can weave in your story. For example, while doing the research, I was fascinated to know about a gentleman called Jadav Molai Payam from Assam. He's called as the forest man of India, and he's a Padma Shri. So, and he, you know, what he has to his credit, he has planted and tended trees on a sandbar on the river Brahmaputra. So, and he has developed a whole forest all by himself. And that forest is named after him, and it's called a Molai forest. So it was very fascinating, the kind of people we have in our country. So then it was an incidental learning. And then we incorporated this as part of the narrative in the story. So this is how a lot of things will come up, which maybe you're not planned. So note it down and make sure that you bring it about in the story. Yes, next slide, please. Very important. Be sensitive about your character portrayal. Be mindful and sensitive towards the culture of the place you're writing about, as it may be outside your own culture. So you have to be very, very careful about this, that please do not pick up any characters or any personalities or any point which may turn controversial. So you have to be very careful about that. I think everybody is sensible enough to know that there are certain topics and certain areas one need not delve into to unnecessary court controversies. And even when you are discussing or during the course of conversation is happening and you're talking about the culture of a specific place or some beliefs of a specific place, maybe religious beliefs or social beliefs, you have to be very mindful to be utterly respectful towards all these matters. In no way can we afford to sound offensive at any point of time. So please be very careful about this. Next piece. Okay. Yes. Ensure you have a conflict included in the story. So your novel will become a lengthy report if there is no conflict. So the key part of writing a good piece of long creative writing is, or even if you're writing a story, there has to be a conflict, there has to be a resolution. Now, conflict can be of two kinds. You can have an inner conflict, you can have an external conflict. Inner conflict is when you show the one of the characters having an inner conflict, maybe a moral dilemma about something, and how the character comes out of it and how the character is able to transcend it. So in our case, we had this character called Bholya. And so he's not part of the main group, but he becomes a part of the group during the storyline. And there's a very sensitive portrayal about the moral dilemma that this boy undergoes through the story, and then what happens as an outcome of that dilemma. So this again makes the writing more interesting. External conflict can be circumstantial. It can be, you know, connected to the way you are developing your story. So in our case, as external conflicts, we have included, you know, there was a theft or robbery which was included in it. We even included an aspect of kidnapping in the story to bring in that, you know, thrilling effect. Otherwise, it can become a little boring if you keep talking about information and if you keep talking about traveling and just about the states. So make sure that you are bringing in some other aspects also to keep up, you know, to bring in a different flavor time and again in the story. It's very, very important to bring in that. So this is something that I wanted to share with you. It's very important to have any kind of a conflict and a resolution in your story. Next is very important to have a touch of humor. So very, very important. Humor can be situational. Humor can be through the conversation of the characters in the story. Humor can be brought on very subtly. It may be some witty remark, some quick response, which is very witty. It could be a shared joke, let it be original. Anything that will draw a smile on your face and will keep the narrative on the lighter side. It shouldn't get heavy. So that's very, very important. Next. Yeah. So before we get into this, to divide the work amongst the people who volunteer to write, see, we've so far said we've had the theme done, we've had the characters done, we've had the travel plan, if you're making a travel plan done, in what way you wish to progress, how you wish to progress, that is decided. And I want to share at this point of time that, you know, you may encounter information fatigue. It happened in my case. So there was so much coming in from Assam, from Rajasthan, and there was so much that I was wanting to put in because it was very fascinating, very interesting, but I knew it's not possible to write about everything. So there came a point when there was an absolute information fatigue in my mind. And there was also travel fatigue happening because I felt I was on a journey along with a group when we were traveling and discovering Rajasthan and Assam. So I physically actually felt the fatigue and I made changes in the story as per that. And when we talk of information fatigue, so there are times when you don't know how to put in a lot in very few words. So I'll just read out a short piece from the book for you, especially when I came to Mewar. The land of Mewar, which is the areas around Udaipur and around it. And there were so many characters from the Indian history about one could write. I mean, it would just make a whole book on its own. So I couldn't do it. So I just took up, I'll just read it out, how I covered a lot of characters in one short paragraph. So I'll just read it out to you. And it happens to be one of my favorite pieces from the book. So this is the guide, the tourist guide, who is informing the group about Mewar. And she says, "This is the land that evokes memories of valor, honor, and glory. The legendary figures of Mewar make this place the epitome of defiance and custodianship of their heritage, even at the cost of their own lives. Defiance was a jewel adorned not only by the men, but even the women of this region. This is the land of the beautiful Rani Padmini, who defied the evil intentions of Alauddin Khilji by preferring to immolate herself in the holy fire of Jauhar rather than surrendering to the enemy. This is the land of Panadhai, who sacrificed her own son to save the future king of Mewar. This is the land of Mirabai, who defied all customs, traditions, and conventions for her steadfast and unequaled devotion to Lord Krishna. The land of Hadirani, who sent across a chopped head as a memento to her husband so he would not get distracted by her presence during wartime. The land of Rana Kumbha, a giant of a personality who fought tirelessly to keep invaders at bay. This is the land of Rana Sangha, whose valor did not abate even upon losing an eye and an arm. He proved to be one of the toughest opponents of the Mughal Sultanate. Mewar shall ever sing the glories of Jaimal and Patta, who died in the defense of Chittorgarh, fighting till the last breath against the invading armies of Akbar. And Mewar will forever remain indebted to Gora and Badal, who also valiantly put their life at stake to save the honor of Chittorgarh. The saga of the legendary heroes of Mewar would be incomplete without speaking about Maharana Pratap, one of the greatest heroes of Indian history. So I wanted to write about all of them, but it was not possible. Now, in this case, what happens is that the children or whoever is reading would be interested to know more about them. And this way to encourage them to read more about these characters and to learn more about them, because we've just given a gist of these characters in the thing. So this is one of the ways where you can actually deal with information fatigue and put in a lot in very few words. And also then there was another place where I found that when writing about Majuli, it is the largest river island in the world. And it figures as one of the fastest disappearing places on earth, something that I didn't know about. And it is the only place in India which has got no carbon footprint. So many things we learned while doing the book. And there was so much coming in from Majuli. It is the hub of the arts and crafts of Assam. And so how to put it? So then I just framed it into a rap song and put in most of the things through a rap song in the chapter. So, you know, there are different ways in which you can deal with your storyline. You can choose to write it as a thriller. You can choose to write it as a mystery. You can choose to write it as historical treatise. It is entirely up to you. So once these things are decided, ask for volunteers from your school. And please do not restrict yourself to the language department, because we feel that, you know, those who are strong with languages would be able to write. It is not so. And I discovered it when we were doing this project, because writing skills is something that many of, people around us have, but they're not even aware of it. So I asked for volunteers who would like to do the writing for certain chapters. And so they all voluntarily picked up cities, states, and the states, of course, there were two states, they picked up cities and they picked up topics and they said, we'll do research and we'll write on this. And I was pleasantly surprised to see that, you know, good pieces came up from unexpected quarters. I mean, it came up from somebody who's teaching science. It came up from somebody who's teaching mathematics, computers, so many other subjects which were not connected to languages. So even children. So it was heartening to see the way they were able to write once they were just given a little guideline. So when you're dividing the works among people who are volunteering to write, you know, don't be set that A can do it and B can't do it. They will surprise you, believe me. And also make it very clear that when somebody is volunteering and giving you to write, it's not necessary what they've written will be taken. So I got very interesting stuff coming in from a lot of quarters, from students and teachers. I was able to pick up a few things from a lot of places. I was not able, though very well written, I was not able to pick up a lot of other things because it did not fit in with the storyline. So everybody has to be very mature about it. Aisa nahi hona chahiye, maine likha, mera likha hua, aapne liya nahi. You know, so this way, everybody was very well sorted out in our school that they are volunteering. It may be picked up, it may not be picked up. It's just 2 points are picked up and nothing else is picked up. So be very clear on these accounts. Next slide, please. Plan your illustrations. Very, very important. As you draw the drafts of chapters as they move by, you should be able to visualize what kind of an illustration you require. So in the book, we have sketches, pencil sketches, we have got charcoal paintings, we have got with pencil colors, with crayons, with this watercolors. And interesting thing, when the book was being made, Miss Anita Karwal told Sandeep sir that I want that different art forms of the country should be incorporated in illustration. So that was a fantastic, guiding light we got. And we have managed to incorporate so many different kinds of illustrations in the book. So I'll just share a few. We have got worldly art, miniature paintings, cross hatching, Bittu art, mandala art, zentangle art, Odisha Pattachitra, Madhubani painting, Kalamkari, Gond, Fud, Doodle, Tenga art from Tanzania, pencil sketches. So many different art forms have been incorporated. So, which is again a very enriching, makes the document more enriching. Because not only for those who are contributing, but for those who would also like to identify and learn more about the different art forms which are available, which are thriving in our country. So plan your illustrations as your chapters move by. So every chapter may have a set of illustrations. There is a catch here. You may end up getting too many made. So watch out for that. So there shouldn't be too many. And be very specific as to what you want. Also, there are times when the maybe the art teachers or the students who are good with fine arts may get inspired by a certain piece of art from the internet or from a book. So in that case, it's always good to adapt it. Don't take it in as it is. Give it your own stroke, change it. You need to be that creative, not to take in something which is available on the internet as it is. So that is something that you need to be careful of. And if you're picking up pictures from the internet, so in our case, we have got photographs also. We've got some pictures we've taken up from the internet. So in case you're taking up pictures from the internet, make sure they're copyright free. Please be very, very clear about that. They have to be copyright free. Else, make sure that you're purchasing them, right? And ensure that you're giving credit. Even if it's copyright free, you have to give the source of your picture from where you picked up and get it checked. Sometimes they look very good on the internet, but they're not fit to be printed. The quality of the image may be very poor. So these are things that you need to keep in mind. Next, please. Yes, keep noting down the web links you have access to get your information, because this piece of work requires a humongous amount of research. And you will actually, when you're doing the research, you will come across several sites and several places. Be careful of where you're taking your information, number one. And take it from trusted sources. Try and take it from government sources only. And also, make sure that you are noting down the links from where you have access to information to weave it into the story. It's very important, because your book should have a bibliography. Like we have bibliography, so here you need to have a bibliography printed which shows from where you have accessed your information. This will add authenticity to your work and will also save you from copyright issues. Yes, please. Next slide, please. Yeah, don't forget to give credit to the sources of your information. So as I said, it may be a web link. It may be a person. So in my case, I was fortunate enough when I got stuck about a cultural issue from Jodhpur. So I was fortunate enough to talk to a person belonging to Jodhpur. I was able to talk to somebody who was from Udaipur, from Assam. And so I could run through a few aspects I was not very clear with, and they gave me a lot of clarity. So we make sure that you give credit to them, since you have taken information from them. So they've been acknowledged in the acknowledgement section. So please don't forget to give credit for any source of information that you gather. Next, please. Keep talking to people around you. As I just told you, while talking to them, I was able to clarify so many of my doubts, and I was more confident while writing, because I knew it had been authenticated by a local person, so it couldn't go wrong. And somebody who was of a very high stature, an educated person who could be trusted to give you the correct information. Especially, as I said, you need to be sensitive when you're talking about the cultural portrayal of an area. So keep talking to people around you. You will be surprised how much you glean out of that. Next, please. Yes, very important. Try and partner with a school from your parent state. Now, in our case, we did try to partner with a school in Assam, but for various reasons, it did not work out. And I wish it could have worked out, because I think then the true spirit of Ek Bharat Shresth Bharat would have come up had we been able to pair with a school in Assam. But for you, I think it will be easier because this initiative, this work is now known by many schools. So even if you put up an offer to a school from your parent states, they're likely to say a yes, because you have a point of reference. So it would be easier for you now after this to pair up with a paired state from your school. So you can think on those lines. Next, please. It's a good idea to impart some life skills along the way and leave food for thought. So again, as I said, it shouldn't be just travel information. You have to give something to the reader to ponder upon, and which the thought that leaves the reader and makes the reader realize the beauty, the diversity of our country, and make the reader really appreciate, you know, and value the culture from where we come from, the greatness of our country. It is very important. So like it is there in sometimes through a conversation, it is there sometimes as a parting note at the end of a chapter. So I'll just share a very short piece with you. So this is when they were talking about the food that I talked to you about. And the children were remarking about what a beautiful diversity we have, even in the ways of cooking and eating and how it affects us. So through the teacher, a dialogue was given, which kind of reiterates about why it is important for us to appreciate every part of our country. It says, nationalism and globalization should become platforms to exercise unity in diversity. As the young upcoming generation, so she's addressing the students, she says, as a young upcoming generation who is going to take over the reins of the country, you must ensure that you teach your peers to respect and celebrate this vast diversity in our land. Never allow it to become a matter of silly debate on parochial supremacy. So these are the kind of things that need to be there, which will give additional food for thought. And then when you are dealing with your case studies, and you are dealing with, if you're going to take that chapter up for your integrated learning, there is so much discussion that can revolve around thought pieces which you leave interwoven in the story in this manner. And it adds more depth to your narrative. Next, please. Yes, be ready to rewrite. So you will write the first draft, you may redo it. And then as you progress in the story, you may have to come back to redo it again, because suddenly you realize that you're writing something contradictory to what you had written earlier as you move ahead. So you will be making a lot of changes in your narrative as you go along. Next, please. Make sure you give the draft for reading to neutral readers from both the states, preferably from both the states. It is important. And of course, to every kind of reader. So when we were preparing the draft, so the draft went to teachers, the draft went to the non-teaching community also, the draft went to the students also. Mm-hmm. Get a feedback and to see what kind of a feedback we get from different age groups and people coming from various backgrounds. And believe me, it really helps. Like, for example, when I was doing this chapter on sustainable energy sources through the energy sources available in Rajasthan and Assam. So there was this chapter on windmills, because Rajasthan happens to have the second largest wind farm in the world, which I didn't know. So when we were doing that, writing about it, this was sent as a draft. So one of the teachers commented that she found the piece very negative. So while writing, I never realized. So then she pointed out that, ma'am, you have focused more on the negative aspects of how the windmill is affecting people living around the windmills. But there is, you've written very less about how important it is as a sustainable source of energy. So when I reread it, I realized how true that was. And had I not given this for a feedback, this feedback would have never come. So taking a cue from this feedback, I was able to revisit and redo a lot of writing that had been done on sources of energy, right? To give it a more balanced look, the pros and the cons from every aspect, because a child has to look at a topic from every aspect, right? Not just the good things or not just the bad things. So a balance has to be maintained. So please make sure that you're sending your drafts out for reading to neutral readers. It will really help you as your work progresses. Next, please. Beware of poetic licenses on the internet. Now, this is very interesting. What does this mean? So I'll give you an example. So when I was doing this piece on Maharana Pratap, a lot is written about Maharana Pratap, such a glorious figure on the internet. And we know that like he's larger than life in Indian history. So when I read about him, so everywhere, it, you know, he's been described as a tall man, 7 feet tall and very, very well built, carrying a spear of 80 kilos, having two swords, 20 kilos each in both his hands, used to carry two swords. And he had his boots were like 10 kilos each and his armor was a specific number of kilos each. And like I read it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so many places. And I said, wow, what a giant of a personality in every aspect. Going back, I said, keep talking to people. So I did have this conversation with Dr. Reema Huja, and she's there as director City Palace, and she's a renowned historian. And so she checked me, and I was also checked by another friend when I discussed this. The friend checked me, and she said, you know, if you go to the Udaipur museum, his clothes, they don't show him to be such a huge person. So just be careful and find out more about it. So that was a red herring. I referred it to Dr. Reema Huja, our historian, and she told me, she says, Urvashi, these, you know, you need to be careful about the poetic licenses people take on the internet. He was actually not such a huge, tall, burlesque personality. He was well-built and strong, no doubt. How can he have an 80 kilo spear? Can you imagine if you take an 80 kilo spear and you throw it across, it will not have its required trajectory. It doesn't serve the purpose. So you need to be careful. Hota kya tha ki jo court poets hote the, wo log raja ki mahima gaane ke liye, wo log lambe lambe poems likhte the. Theek hai? Aur wo poems, they have carried over the centuries. Un poems mein wo log raja ki ki hui cheezon ko aur mahima gaan karne ke liye unki personality ke saath jod dete the. Aur wo poetic license, poetic way ke andar wo likha jata tha. Now, when those get posted on the internet, people start taking it to be how the king was actually, how the king actually was. So these are things you need to be very careful about. If you find something is like a bit too fantastic and it is like a bit too glorified, make sure you just dig in a little deeper and you find out what is the truth. Don't get caught with your poetic licenses. Okay, next, please. Has the slide changed?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So now once your story is done, you have done your writing, your draft, your illustrations, everything is done. Yes. So once your story is done, then of course it goes back. The chapters go back to the teachers and they map the story as per the NCERT learning objectives and outcomes. And it was such a huge learning experience to see that we were able to map the learning objectives and outcomes right from grade 3 for certain chapters and right up to grade 12 and across subjects. So it was done and it was not difficult, but it was there. So it complements beautifully with whatever you're teaching them in the school. It is a very powerful additional tool when you do the writing. So that work also, and it showed that it is not difficult to do interdisciplinary work. There is so much focus coming on integrated learning and interdisciplinary learning. And this piece of writing prove to all of us that actually it is not so difficult. We just need to have a little shift in the way we think and we approach things. Next slide, please. Priyanka, can we have the next slide? Do the case-based questions. Now, this is the last thing that you're going to do once everything is done and sorted out. So this should be the last thing to be done. So this book, The Camel with the Japi, comes with a complimentary, a supplementary booklet, which carries 64 case studies taken from the chapters, cut across 12 subjects. Subjects as diverse as English, maths, science, and in sciences, physics, chemistry, biology, accountancy, entrepreneurship, you know, business studies, economics. So again, it was such a beautiful journey of discovery and learning, even as the case-based questions came across. So for all of us in the Palace School, it has been a huge learning journey. So we learned at various levels. So it's been a fantastic journey all along. Next slide, please. Most important thing for you to do is to enjoy the process, as we have done. Thoroughly enjoyed the whole process. And I have to thank Sandeep sir, because it is with his guidance that this book became a comprehensive educational document. If he was not there, believe me, we would have just probably done the story and full stop, done the novel and full stop. But he encouraged us and guided us to get the learning objectives and the learning outcomes together. He encouraged us to get the case-based questions to be done. And as we did it, we were so pleasantly surprised to see how much is possible. And this actually proved to all of us how storytelling can be such a powerful pedagogical tool, not only for the one who's reading, but also the one who's also framing questions from it. And the same piece of chapter, the same chapter, and maybe the same extract has been used by different subjects to frame questions as per their subject. So the casebook that is along with it has got case-based studies along with the learning outcomes, and telling you which class and which topic of the particular subject it talks about, mapped with from which chapter of the book it has taken. So it's been a lot of work, but a fantastic journey all along for us. So thank you so much, Sandeep sir, because it was your vision that actually has enriched us and made this into a comprehensive educational document. So happy writing to all of you. If there's any way that I can be of any help, please let me know. And Sandeep sir is there as our mentor always. So that's how it is. Over to you, Sandeep sir. Thank you so much for being patient listeners.
So thank you so much, Rishi ma'am. And I go back once again on 29th when we met Anita ma'am. And you know, teachers and principals, I think for the past 4-5 months, we have been showing different stages of work to Manoj sir and Biswajit Saha sir. So whenever we got an opportunity to go to Delhi, we gave him the work, showed him the work, and the way they motivated us, because they were really excited, you know, aisa ho sakta hai, this also can happen. Oh, the national, it's as per the NEP, it is as per the NCRT-based network. You know, everything of that kept on motivating us to do that very challenging task. So finally, it was on 29th when we met Biswajit sir, Manoj sir, and Anita ma'am that day, and Jyoti ma'am, of course, there was with us. So we really, like, you know, when she saw the book, she was very excited, and hamesha ki tarah, why not more? So why not more mein aap log sab abhi hum log ke saath mein hai to complete that why not more with her. And of course, she's given us a task of target of 3 months to finish the task. And because she said, I don't know if it will happen or not, but of course she did say it, both of you all are evidence for that. She said, I'm going to get it printed by the National Book Trust of India. Right? Ab wo hota hai ki nahi hota hai? 15 books. That's why she wanted 3 months to get the work done by them, because they'll do very extensive research and editing part that way. So, but anyway, we just have to go with the flow, with the tide, give her the task by the end of 3 months. And then let's see what happens. She wants to have a grand launch of it by the PMO. So there is a lot of challenge on us, but one thing, don't jump to the case studies first. First, enjoy the story, then come to the technical part. We'll take a session again with you all. As you finish off, we can do it one-to-one also, not to worry, about how to go along with the case studies and things like that. So, gadbad ho jayega agar aapne case studies ko pehle pakad liya, to then you will not be able to go ahead the right way. And anything more anyone has to say or ask, please ask. And Reema ma'am, you have anything to share, because you've been a part of this journey and you've seen the excitement around. So anything you have to say, please go ahead and take your turn.
Sir, if I may please interrupt, I would just like to know as to how many stories we can incorporate. Would there be any limit?
No, ma'am. It's all up to you all now. You know, it has to be different. That's why we said there's no protocol. That's why there's no prototype. So you have to do it the way you feel like doing it.
Okay. And sir, would we get the recording of the same, please, on the group?
Yeah, we'll be sharing that too, yes.
Okay.
Now, one more question. Is it mandatory to discuss root in the story, like ma'am was telling?
Just repeat the question once again, ma'am.
Is it mandatory to discuss the complete root in the story?
It's again up to you, ma'am, how you want to cover up the thing. So you have your objectives, how you want to fit them and need them around the story. That's up to you.
Heroes we can incorporate, like political, we'll not be talking about.
I think you should not touch anything, as ma'am has said, don't touch anything controversial. Why get into trouble? Because that will take more time for the book to be edited. So why get stuck there, you know? Why get, don't take up any controversial thing.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, while zeroing down the settings, suppose if you have taken any rural character, so what yes. kind of liberty we can take with the language?
I think you do that. Go ahead. You can have it that way. But remember, see, two of the principals said we are going to make that book in Hindi. So the problem kya ho gaya? Ki jo state partnering hai, wo South India ka hai. So even Anita ma'am said we should have them in English and Hindi both, but pehle ek language mein convert kar lo, because your partnering state should also be able to understand that language. Because there's no point if you're doing something in Punjab and Tamil Nadu, and you're putting Punjabi terms there which Tamil Nadu people not will understand. So you'll have to play on that and keep on translating that.
So one more thing is there. What else we can take except this traveling? Like ma'am has taken.
Sir. Which school are you from, Anil sir?
Sir, Blue Bay Solic School.
Yeah. So yeah, aap log apna group pe baith ke decide kare kya aapko format leke chalna hai. It's free for all. You decide. Like ma'am ne do char kisse bataye. This was the tour going from Jaipur to for Rajasthan, and it covered up all aspects. And you decide what you want to do. Someone wants to take it in fiction. Someone wants to have some other way. Means a lot of principals have shared what they're doing. I don't want to share it to make it common. So I'm keeping my mouth shut here, because I think everyone can explore that. Kisi ka same bhi nikal aayega, koi tension ki baat nahi hai, but take your own way.
So one thing I wanted to share, I think that will interest the teachers here, that even for curation, we have used our children also, our students. And they were as young as in grade 8. And it was amazing the kind of curation. So there was a piece in which, there is something is written about if we go by a car, it'll take us so many minutes. If we go walking, it'll take us so many minutes. It is so many kilometers away. And now what do you want to do? So these kids had been given, as the drafts were getting ready, it was being shared with some children who were very enthusiastic, and they were told ki ma'am ne kaha hai ki isme se galtiyan nikalo. So that got them super excited ki ma'am ne kaha hai galtiyan nikalo. And so this boy actually, and that's where I got to know, my God, this is such a powerful learning tool. He actually sat down and questioned his mother and further his maths teacher ki ye jo likha hua hai isme, इसके हिसाब से अगर इतना किलोमीटर मतलब जो उसने बोला उसने पूरा यूनिटरी मेथड लगा दिया उस पीस ऑफ राइटिंग को चेक करने के लिए. सो एंड इट वाज समथिंग दैट वी कुड नेवर इमेजिन. दिस वाज कमिंग फ्रॉम अ स्टूडेंट. सो इवन फॉर स्टूडेंट्स इट वाज सच एन एनरिचिंग जर्नी एंड दे डिड गिव सम ब्यूटिफुल इनपुट्स. Where language was concerned, vocabulary was concerned, sometimes certain expressions were concerned. So even for students, it's been a huge learning journey. So that was something I missed out to share with you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Can I come in then, Sandeep sir and Urvashi ma'am?
Yes,
my greetings to everyone who is on this online webinar today. I'm even seeking words because, you know, there's a stage where we had again got back to being in person.
Yes.
So thank you for allowing me to speak, and thank you for doing such a great job on the prototype which has come out, even though you didn't want the word prototype used. Urvashi ma'am, it was a pleasure working with you on this. You asked very few but very pertinent questions. You showed your material. You had such, it was a wonderful learning experience to me. And that is the point I want to come to. I think this is going to be a great tool. So if it was Anuj sir whose question you were asking, again, I think even from this of what we take up, particularly as we are back to not having schools open in many parts of the country, this can be a way of getting not just the faculty and some of the senior students, but even others involved right from the thing of what theme do we take. You people are the teachers. You will have to figure out what question you want to ask and get them. But, you know, just thinking on which stories you can have. That is one part I wanted to just emphasize there. What you talk about, how you talk about it can become a learning tool, particularly in this semi weird phase we are in January 2022. Coming back to the congratulations, I think this whole endeavor to have, you know, NCERT's got everyone involved, Ek Bharat, Shreshth Bharat. We are doing so many things here. And then to use storytelling as a medium, because storytelling is something that appeals to all of us, any age, and is particularly good when it comes to the students who are again in after kind of, you know, almost 2 years plus of not knowing where we are going with classes, not wanting to get, some of them want to sit in a classroom. A lot of them are not used to it, but they want to go to school. Can be ways of running stories past them. Maybe the way we used to when I was at school and there was a big project going on, and the seniors would be doing most of the work, but the juniors would be given certain tasks to do. So that is there. I think the true potential of this is going to come out as we start using these more and more. You know, I haven't even got around to looking at the case studies. I'm waiting for it to go beyond. Is it on Diksha that it is on the website?
It's not been put up anywhere. They're it's just, not been put up. The board is going to display that because, we were asked to give the soft copies. We are giving them to Diksha. They'll be putting it out along with the link here.
Okay. But so here is one person who's very keen. I have seen an early copy, but I am waiting for the formal launch, which obviously the right authorities will be doing in due course. But I think the sooner this book and the others, and I just want to bring in the graphic novel. I know it's not part of this theme right here, but the schools have been working so actively on so many things. I think we've started a revolution of sorts in using the medium you're using. And more or less my final point, because I don't want to hog too much time here, but when I was at school, when I was a kid, there was a lot of this whole thing of a lot of my peer group were not allowed to read comics because they said it's going to spoil your language. My parents couldn't care less as long as I was reading. You know, they were fine. And as long as I was playing, it was, you needed to have a balance in their view. And I still remember we had 11th in my time. So in between a paper, I had prepared what I wanted to. And I, after a point, my brain goes if I overread something. And my mother said, well, you've got a new novel to read. Why don't you just read it? You know, unlike a lot of parents who would say, padho, and you get. So coming again back to that issue, then I was allowed to read things, including comic books. The others were not. Whereas, used rightly, any tool is a learning tool. So you people are not just gurus for your teachers. This has been a great experience for me. And I always remember my teachers. And in continuation of that, all the teachers sitting here, thank you very much, Gurujis. Do well with this. Thank you for making me part of this. The MSMS2 Museum, the Prince Diya Kumari Foundation, all of us here, the the museum, greater museum family, will be very happy to continue to do our bit for education. And I think this goes for all of us. Once again, thank you for having me here. I have been listening in many times. Sandeep sir is very generous when he shares his links, but I don't always speak. And I plan not to always speak, because that's too much taking away time from the relevant questions. But again, final point, I have no idea who said this to me, but it stayed with me. So it has to have been a teacher. That a true scientist, I think it was Professor Lokanathan, actually, Rajasthan University, who said that a child is the best scientist ever, because the child is always asking questions. So why is the sky blue? And you can't just say because, it'll say, but why? So thank you for making me continue to ask questions by doing this wonderful work you're doing. Good luck to you all. More strength to your elbow, as an old-fashioned term used to be. Look forward to seeing where our other teachers, our other faculty, other schools go with their Ek Bharat Shreshth Bharat project. Thanks again. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And teachers and principals, any queries, please ask, or we can take a liberty to wind up the session. So thank you, Reema ma'am, once again. Thank you, Urvashi ma'am, once again. And thank you, everyone, for being there. And well, your deadline is 3 months, and we have to finish up and present the work to Anita Karwal ma'am. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Which is a basic necessity.
Thank you, Urvashi ma'am. Thank you, Sandeep sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Access current information.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.